Scripture reading, sing to Yahweh, you are his favorite, faithful ones, and praise his holy name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor a lifetime. Weeping you may spend the night, but there is joy in the morning. When I was secure, I said I would never be shaken. Psalms chapter 30, 4 through 6. Comfort, comfort, my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and announce to her that her time of forced labor is over. Her iniquity has been pardoned, and she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one crying out, prepare the way for the Lord in the wilderness and make a straight highway for our God in the desert. Isaiah 40, 1 through 3.
You want to go light it now?
Yeah.
Okay. It's right over there. Oops. Yes.
The importance of preparation. Whenever we're on a mission with God, like Joseph and Mary,
whereas they waited for the birth of Jesus, we have to prepare. No one plants seeds one day and expects a harvest in the morning. There are things to do. We are called to cultivate our lives and rest in the fact that God has our future in his hands. In the story of the prodigal son, Jesus tells a story of a father. This father knew that he couldn't control the will of rebellious, spiteful son. He just gave him what he asked for and let him go. But after the son left with his share of the farm in his back pocket, the father began to prepare for a celebration. He started fattening a calf. He bought a ring and a robe. There were things to be done. Their relationship was broken, but he still had hope as he watched every afternoon for a familiar figure to appear over the horizon. Preparation is a statement of faith. It's committing to trust, even though you're hurting and heartsick. Every detail of the Christmas story tells us that Mary and Joseph endured more than their fair share of trials as they waited for the arrival of Jesus. Mary left town. Joseph refused to reject her on the bias of an angelic dream. We can just hear the neighbors gossip about the scandalous events of Mary's pregnancy. But they prepared and endured it all to be on a much greater mission than any carpenter's family could imagine. Application, preparing for God's plan. As you prepare for Christmas and all God has in store for you in the new year, be challenged to prepare for all that's in store in the following ways. Eliminate distractions. Don't allow the stress of Christmas season to distract you from what is really important. Spend more time with the family and less time at the mall. Simplify your life. Be still and listen to God's voice. Keeping your eyes on Jesus, the source of the perfecter of faith. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Notice God's hands. Reflect on the past year. Perhaps you, like many, have face financial difficulty, or maybe you escaped danger or disease through an unforeseen miracle. Perhaps this year has been a time in suffering or relationship disasters. How has God carried you through all these things? Remember the words of Joseph in the Old Testament. You planned evil against me, God planned it for good. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. Discern God's will. Ask God to give you direction. A man's heart's plan his way, but the Lord determines his step.
That's right.
Proverbs 16, verse 9. United mission. Mary and Joseph undertook an amazing mission on the way to Bethlehem. It certainly must have strengthened their bond as they conquered many obstacles and challenges. There's nothing more powerful than a couple, a family, or a church rallying around a cause.
Amen. Amen. A week to prepare. Thank you, brother.
You're welcome.
A week to prepare. We should be focusing on Jesus coming. That's the purpose of Christmas. It's not about all the things that we get wrapped up in, right? Am I right? We get wrapped up in all these other things, but it's about Jesus. The whole thing's about Jesus. Amen. Well, to announce a few things to you, too. Don't forget about Wednesday nights. You're very welcome to come. Don't forget about Thursday nights, how we meet here at the church. I want to pray over the service, and I want to pray over the offering, because this is the second Sunday of the month. So we're going to take up an offering for the building. Not very long ago, I had got to do something I've never done before. I took a $109,998 check down to Gary, Oklahoma. Gosh, God is so good. I mean, He is so good. $2 short of $110,000. We went and paid off this building. And, I mean, you ever pray something but you don't know if you have the faith to go with it? Man, I was praying that prayer. Pastor Giles, when he left, he said, "We're going to pay this off soon." I was like, "How?" I was the guy on the elder board that goes, "Man, all the money. Oh, man, I don't know how we're going to do this." But I agreed to line up with the prayer, even though I knew that my faith was lacking. And God has paid us off, and He is so good, and we should give Him praise. Also, now that we have paid the building off, we don't have to worry about that debt, but we do still want to do things with this building. And we have a youth building. That's our focus next. We've been given a building. It's attached to this building. If you don't notice, it's on the back side, on the south side. And it is something we're getting to go in and renovate and do a whole bunch, but we'll have to have the funds. And they've been coming in, praise God. And we just want to invest this money wisely. And I need you to pray with me that God will help us do this, that we'll have the right contractors, that we'll have the right people with everything we do here, that every bit of the money will be used exactly the way it should be, with not one penny squandered or spent wrongly. And just as importantly, that as we do these things, that we grow together as a church, that we connect with these contractors and the people that come in who don't know who they're coming in to deal with. They don't know that we're praying for them. They don't know that when they step into this place, that we're lifting them up in prayer and we're believing that Jesus is going to meet them face to face in this building. So pray with me, please. Father, we're so blessed to be here in Your house today. And Father, we praise You for paying this building off. And we pray, Lord God, that You'll continue to bring the funds in, that we can expand and that we can fix and that we can improve, so that this whole facility, Father, everything we do in this house will not be for a social club, even though we love each other. And it will not be for self-gain in any way. But this place and this facility and these ministries in this house are 100% for Your kingdom and Your glory, Lord Jesus. Please don't let us misspend one thing as we come to You in full, total dependence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go ahead, gentlemen. Pastor, you want to come up here? And if you don't have money today and you wanted to give into the building fund, you can designate. You can put over there later in the little pouches that we have over by the drop-off, by the boxes. You can designate on their building fund. A lot of people do that. And you can also text online and leave a message and tell us, by what I understand, can't you, Pastor? And say specifically, "I want to give this to the building fund." All right. Do you want to speak or do you want me to start this off? Yes, ma'am. Oh, is that important? Christmas plays next week for the kids? I was going to do that at the end, but yes, we could talk about it beginning and end. Christmas plays next week is something we've done here for years. The kids have been working hard. It's going to be great this year. It will be the whole entire service besides worship next week. So we won't be preaching next week. We'll have the kiddos up here giving us a play, and it's going to be great. So please come for that. Did I miss anything else, my better half? We will have a Christmas Eve service, that's right. Know about that too. I guess that's kind of close now. But thinking about where we want to go. Talking to my pastor team. I'm one of three guys. I brought a message 2 weeks ago. And in that message, I called some of y'all and said, I want y'all to come. And I want you to see what I was doing. And pretty much the gist of the message was this. It was a demonstration. And it was to demonstrate with the glass vase that Jan loaned us. I put some ping pong balls in it. And I showed how we filled our lives with things. And we've got things within us that we want to get rid of. And the only way they're going to get rid, be gone, is for Jesus to fill us up. To be filled with the Holy Spirit. And as I poured that water, then the ping pong balls would float to the top. Jesus will always displace everything in your life that he doesn't want. John said, John the Baptist said that Jesus is an all-consuming fire. And he will burn up the things in our lives. In Revelations, he has eyes of fire. And he burns and seeks within us the things that he doesn't like. And he will change us. And as I poured the water in there, the vase, the ping pong balls came up and they floated out. And there was many illustrations involved, but the gist was that when you have Jesus within you, everything else gets displaced. And the only way to displace those things is by Jesus. When he said, I am the way, the truth, and life, he is the only way for us to be cleansed and to have those things removed in our life. So last week, Pastor Colton stood in for us. We had things going on. I was on campus. My brother, he was able to make it. Pastor was able to make it, but he had to go because he had a passing in his family. And Pastor Colton came up here and he brought a message last week and I really loved it. I'm really proud of how far he's come. He has came so far. And in that message, he wanted to share something, and he went to Genesis chapter 3. And Roxanne, if you can pull that up from Genesis chapter 3 verse 8 so we can read and revisit what Pastor Colton said. And this is in the Garden of Eden after Adam and Eve had sinned. And it says, they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God. Now, God had walked with them every cool of every day. But now they hid themselves. They hid among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, where are you? So right there, y'all remember that message from last week, those that were here? The point was, something was at play in their life that was not of God. And we think it was the sin. It is true that sin separated them from God. It is sin that brought the fall of man. But the fear, the emotion, separated them from God. When God wanted to know where they're at, he didn't say, sinner. He didn't say, how could you do this to me? We know because before the foundation of the world, Jesus was slain. God had knew the whole time what was going to happen. And our Father wanted to be with them. Even though they had sinned, he wanted to be with them. So we see here this illustration in the Word of God that fear separated them from God. Now, it is true that our sins separate us from Him. I'm not taking away from that. But the point is, the attitude of the Father, the attitude of our Father was, where are you? And that's the attitude of the Father to every human being, because He has made the propitiation in the blood of Jesus Christ for the redemption of our sins, right? So, looking at that, He says, where are you? Can you pull that back up for me? In verse 10. So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid. Adam spoke the truth. I was afraid. Because I was naked, and I hid myself. Verse 11, the last verse we'll look at. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you that you should not eat? This is a rhetorical question. Our Father knew exactly what happened. God can't be God and not know all things. He's putting the ball in this court saying, where are you? Did you do this? He's leading him down a path of redemption, because that's what our God does. But what's at play is emotional separation from God. It's emotionalism. And if we could title this today, if Pastor still agrees with me, it's the Word of God versus emotionalism. Our emotions can hurt us, can't they, Pastor? Can you talk about that?
You know, from a practical sense, you know, we, our entire lives are often governed by emotions, feelings. We have good days and we have bad days. We have okay days and we have all not so okay days. So there's a lot of things that come into our lives that we deal with, and we just think it's just the way it is. It's just the way we're supposed to be. But you know, when we come into the faith and we turn our hearts to Him and we follow Jesus, it's not, our feelings don't go away.
Right.
Okay? But our mind should change, and our way of thinking should change. Let this mind that was in Christ also be in you, right? So we have a new way of approaching things, a new mindset. The subtitle to Pastor Zach's message as we were discussing this, I think the subtitle would be, there's no emoji for faith. You know, we how many emojis do you have for all the feelings that go on in your life that you use on your cell phone? How many use those emojis on your cell phone? You know, I never thought I would use emojis, but I use emojis. I'm a grown man, and I put a smiley face on a text message or a frown or something to express myself without having to put it all into words. And a lot of times we do that in our own lives when it comes to our relationship with God. We put a blank face or a smiley face. What's the saying? God is good, and God is good all the time, and
all the time
God is good, right? So God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Well, that's true. God is good. The Word says that. But do you always feel that God is good?
Right.
Amen? When you're sick in your body, do you always feel that God is good? When you've had reoccurring issues with the same sin or the same issues, do you feel that God is good? Amen? So it's easy for us to say that, and that is the truth. But it seems almost careless to just throw a blanket statement out there that's supposed to cookie-cut shape and fit everyone's issues. So that's why you don't hear Pastor Zach and I even talking about that in the church here, as God is good all the time, because we know it's true. He is good.
That's right.
But we're concerned about where you are right now. And where you are you hiding? Are you blending into the things in your world? Because that's what Adam and Eve did in that moment. They stepped back into creation and to begin to blend into the things that were around them rather than standing out in the way that God had created them to. They didn't look like anything on earth. We don't. Now, some of us are a little bit more hairier than others, but we don't look like anything else on earth. And when we have our problems and we have issues in our lives, in particular sin, what we tend to do is gravitate back into that old way of thinking, that old way of doing things, because it's the way that we feel. Amen? Let me share a few scriptures with you as I begin to look through this. The definition first of emotion: a natural instinctive state of mind deriving from one's circumstances, mood, or relationships with others. The second part of that, instinctive or an intuitive feeling distinguished from reasoning or knowledge. So these emotions in us, both of them are described as natural and intuitive, something that automatically comes out, right? When a baby is upset, you can tell the difference between a baby that's crying who's hungry and a baby who's crying who's hurting. Can you? Mothers. Amen? There's a difference in their cry. God created us that way. And there's nothing wrong with expressing that when you're going through the moment. But as we mature and we get older, we just can't scream and cry because we have emotions to each other. Sometimes we have to cry out. We have to remember that we have to cry out to Him. That has to come as a result of our minds being changed. Philippians 2:5, the scripture I just quoted, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. That's Philippians 2:5. Matthew 16:23. This is when Jesus was talking to Peter and his disciples. And Jesus is talking to them, and Jesus asked them a question. And I'm gonna skip that scripture real quick. Let's look at Romans 8:5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. There is a difference in where you set your mind on.
Right.
There is a difference in the things that we follow when we become believers. Not that we're not having feelings, not that we're not having emotions, but we set our minds that we don't follow the feelings. But we are led by the Spirit of God. And the last scripture here, Colossians 3:2, set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on this earth. What are the things that are on this earth? What are the thoughts processed in this earth? One of the main thought processes that is in this world right now is outrage. There's something to be outraged about all the time. Is there an emoji for outrage? Is there something you can put up that says, I'm just upset about everything? We can easily tie into what's going on in our world and around us. And we can link up with those feelings, and we can be outside of the desire that God wants us to walk in because we have blended in to this world.
That's right. Can you put up the definition of emotionalism? I don't know if you get that typed up yet, but I'm going to talk about that while you get it ready. I accepted Christ when I was a little kid in a little Christian school. I was 5 years old, and I remember that moment. I know it was real. And the reason I know it's real because I believed God's word, not because of a feeling. I didn't feel something tremendous. I do remember the moment, but I just knew God's word was true. I just, when you get that revelation that God's word is true. Well, fast forward to when I'm 18 years old, and I had been in church, but I had fallen away. And this relates to me on emotions because I've taken some of y'all down this road with me before and explained to you that I had dealt with habitual sin as teenagers, and as some of us still do today. And my habitual sin, I thought that there's no way, because of a wrong teaching of a Bible teacher. Wrong teaching, I said this last week, I'll tell you again. Anything we say in here, you have to filter through the Word of God. And our interpretation can be wrong, and our perspective can be wrong, and your perspective can be wrong. But God's Word will not be wrong. It just won't. And God bless this person. I love her. It's a long time back. She said something to me, and maybe it was me. I'm a middle school boy. Maybe I perceived it wrong. She didn't say it that way. But the point is, I decided that I was unforgivable. Have y'all ever felt that way before? That's an emotion. That's nowhere in the Word of God. Matter of fact, the Word of God says over and over again with great number of verses, anything you do can be forgiven by Jesus. The Father has poured out His blood to forgive you of anything. I'll never forget the phone call from Pastor Giles when he called me up and asked how I was. And I said, to be honest with you, I'm not in a good place. And he said, why are you that way? And I said, well, someone had said this. He said, that's not what the scriptures say. And it was an emotional thing for me. My emotions were incorrect. I had a wrong interpretation, whether it was taught me, whether she'd been to teach it that way or not. My interpretation was wrong, but it comes down to my emotions had separated me from coming to church and it separated me from following God. And we want to call this an emotionalism, if you can pull that up. The definition of emotionalism from the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, as Pastor said here, emotions are a gift from God. They're a blessing, and they can sometimes be a hindrance. They can hurt you. They can help you. They're beautiful. They're valuable. But they can also be wrong, and we're most definitely, definitely not to be led by our emotions. That's the point. So, definition one of emotionalism is a tendency to regard things emotionally. A tendency to regard things emotionally. To always be emotional in how you feel about things. And Pastor and I have said that as a church, that's something that churches use. That's something that everyone uses, from the movies to advertisements. It's used in business. It's used in government. It's used around the world to use people's emotions to direct them. Use everything as emotionally as you can. And we have a concern about that. And we want you to raise your hands and worship the Lord here. But we don't want to become an emotional people who are led by our emotions versus the Word of God. Definition two is an undue indulgence in or display of emotion. An undue indulgence in or display of emotion. And I think you can see how that fits right along with definition one. That emotions can lead you wrong. They're not. And we see that through the Word of God from Genesis chapter 3. We just read that Adam and Eve's emotions, that fear, had separated them from God. And we can go all the way to the end of the Word of God in Revelation to see how emotions control people.
You know, talking about your youth, you know, I think many of us can relate to that, how we've been through something in our lives, some issues with God or sin that we've had in our lives as a youth, and how we went to someone with that issue, or went to a pastor or someone that we thought was godly in their instruction, and we heard them, and it ministered to our heart in a different way than what we had expected. And it caused us to see ourselves in the way that we think that somehow we're unforgivable in a way, or that we're unfixable.
Right.
Have you ever felt that way? Like you've got issues that you can't not fix. Like there's something in my heart that I was made wrong. I'm going to live my life this way because this is the way I feel. See, I don't know about you, but I've been to church camps as a youth. And you go to church camp, and there are kids like you from all over the place, and there's everyone gathered together having fun, and you have the service, and songs are being sang, and you know, after a night or two, you see people responding to the call of the pastor, to the word that's being preached, and everyone's walking down front, and people are making a life change and giving their lives to the Lord because of the word that's being preached and because of the atmosphere and the environment that's around them, right?
Right.
And they see that, and there is an experience that's taking place. And then they come home and they're telling their friends and they're telling their families, I'm saved and I'm changed and everything's
fired
great.
Up.
And man, yeah, they're fired up. And what happens over a number of weeks? And as they get into school, it begins to wane, right? And you're like, man, I thought my kid was just so fired up for the Lord. And it just seems like they just kind of went back the other way. They've kind of settled down. Well, the problem is that they were riding on a mountaintop high.
Right.
They were riding on an experience. An experience in and of itself is full of feelings, full of emotions. But that won't sustain you.
Right.
That's going to go away. Those feelings, those issues, those things that occurred at that time are going to go away because they're based on the feeling. Most Christians who come to the Lord, young believers, experience this or go through this problem all the time. And it seems like a roller coaster. There's times when they're up spiritually. I'm reading my Bible. I'm praying. I'm seeking God. You can see it in their attitude and their personalities. They want to tell you. And then there's times when they're down. And they're like, oh, man, I'm just struggling. I'm having a hard time, a difficult time. And no one came and said, life is that way. There's going to be ups. There's going to be downs. But you can't base everything you do based on your experience, based on your feelings. Trust that the Word of God is going to sustain you through whatever you're going through. Trust that God is going to be there even when it doesn't feel like He is. Amen? See, great spiritual moments, this is a note that I wrote down last night, are often followed by great temptations. You go to church camp and you have a great time at church camp and you feel clean and you feel worthy again. And you come back to school, and the girl who's never paid any attention to you, all of a sudden, is standing by your locker. The guy who is the captain of the football team, who's never even looked at you, all of a sudden, he's sending you a note. Those things come into our lives at those points to kind of tempt us. Do you know who's at play at that point? It's the enemy. He knows that you're on a spiritual high. He knows that you have engaged with God and you have called, asked Him to change your life and there's something new. But that doesn't mean that the things in our lives are going to, the issues are going to go away.
That's right.
In fact, they're going to come sometimes even greater.
That's right.
Let me show you something here. Luke chapter 4, Jesus was led into the wilderness immediately after being baptized, hearing God's audible voice, and the Spirit of God descending on him like a dove. Has anyone had that happen to you? Well, it happened to Jesus. The Word explains that to us in Luke chapter 3. And immediately, the Bible says, he was led into the wilderness to be what? Tempted of the devil.
That's right.
So, he went from a great high point, a great experience, to immediately going into temptation. Here's another example. When I told you I was going to go back to later. Matthew 16, let's look at verses 13 through 20 real quick. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? Who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter, everyone knows Peter, he replies, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him and said, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. Now, if that wasn't a mountaintop experience for Peter, I don't know what was. Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, you are right, Peter. Flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. The heavens told you this. God opened up his mouth and spoke to your heart. How do you think Peter felt when Jesus began to say that? We know Peter's issues, his feelings were on his sleeves. He wore them on his sleeves, and that was part of his problem. That was a mountaintop experience for Peter. But what happened right after that? It didn't take long. Matthew 6:21, let's drop down to 6:21. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised again. And Peter took him aside. Oh, now, Jesus, come over here now. Now, Jesus, don't be telling these people that this is going to happen.
Right.
Be it far from you. I got your back. Mm-hmm. Be it far from you to think that these things are going to happen. Don't be telling the people that when I'm right here with you. This shall never happen to you, is what Peter says to Jesus. But he turned and said, who turned? Jesus said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. Wait a minute. He was just son of Barjona. He was just blessed just a couple of scriptures ago. Now he's Satan? I'm going to tell you right now. He went from the mountaintop to the valley just like that. Feelings. Can the word of God be working in your life and your feelings be wrong? Can a word of God be leading you in your life and you somehow think, oh, this must mean that I need to go do this. This must mean that I need to say this to that person. That's when your feelings get out in front of the word. That's when your feelings get out in the way of what God is calling you to do in your life. From mountaintop to valley, don't trust your feelings. Trust the word.
You know, Pastor, Jesus explains further what happened there. He says in verse 23, you read, get behind me, Satan. Mm-hmm. Jesus was speaking to Satan, who was directing the thoughts of Peter. Jesus loved Peter. Jesus didn't have beef with Peter. He had to correct Peter, but he was correcting what was behind him. What's it say in verse 23? Get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but of the things of man. So what that shows is he was messing it all because he was thinking like a man. That's right. So I want to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and show you what I've seen recently here that helps us understand this more. When I took that vase and I poured that water into it, that is a great display to me of what we have studied. We did a book called Basic Elements of the Christian Faith by Watchman Nee, and it explained that when you accept Christ, he goes deep, deep, deep into you. It doesn't say he goes in your brain. It doesn't mean he immediately changes your thought life, but he goes deep into you. And then from within your spirit, deep in your heart, you begin to be led by the Lord to know, I can't do this anymore. Your brain says, I want to do this. Your brain says, I think this way. Your brain says one thing, but the spirit of the Lord speaking to your spirit, you have two spirits in you. You have the Holy Spirit, and therefore your spirit is alive and born again. Otherwise, you wouldn't have a spirit, but the Holy Spirit's there speaking to your spirit, bearing witness in your heart. You cannot do this anymore. This is unacceptable and it's not going to happen. So what happens is, from back to my illustration, is the Holy Spirit goes right through all the junk. He knows that your mind's messed up. He knows that you're not where you need to be. But when you focus on receiving Jesus and worshiping him and being in his word and receiving that grace that lifted those ping pong balls out of the vase and displayed them, that's got to begin with you not using your mind thinking, am I worthy of this? Is this going to work? Is this... That's stinking thinking. That has no place. So looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Oh, my phone's not working. Maybe it's me. Just maybe. Verse 3. The Apostle Paul is speaking to the church in Corinth, and he's been talking to them about how his authority is, and the church's authority too. His authority and their authority spiritually. He says in verse 3, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war against the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. So I've thought for a long time, and it's true, there are spiritual strongholds in the spiritual realm around us. And I thought this is applicable to the spiritual strongholds that are up around us in the heavenlies, around cities and around the world. But look what this says. Scripture interprets Scripture. Praise God for that. If anybody ever says, what's that Scripture say? You got to read the chapter. You can't just pick a verse. Verse 5, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So what's our mighty power that we have? We have the Spirit of God pulling down strongholds, and those strongholds are here. You got it? They're here. Because what it says here is anything explains a stronghold, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Becoming a pastor is interesting. One of the things that's interesting is, just like other people, you think, I know that God's anointed us and He calls us and He gives us the ability, but what we don't quit doing is being human beings. We don't quit thinking like people. Every day we have to think, and actually it seems to be harder, because when you walk into a position with responsibilities, then the enemy, as Pastor said earlier, the battle increases when you go into a responsible position, because the enemy wants to pull you down. He wants to beat you up. And it's amazing that difficulties or temptations and challenges still come in that I haven't done in 20 years. Or things, you know, the enemy brings up what I did when I was in high school and I've been up for 20 years and how I'm unworthy and how these things are. Those are not of my Father. They have no place. And I have to realize that I have, from the Word of God here, an ability to bring every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. So back to the Watchman Nee, we did that, and I would like to give anyone in here, it's electronic and you can also get it in printed form, it's called Basic Elements of the Christian Faith. It's said in there, and it demonstrated that you've got your spirit and your soul, and that's what we're talking about today. We're talking about the spirit and the soul. When the Spirit of God comes into you, you will begin to receive direction from the Spirit, but you are so used to being led by your soul that you don't know which one's which. You don't know. I've given you all the example before, working at the pharmacy. If you remember my example from 2 weeks ago, when that man kept coming to my mind every day, and I didn't realize how valuable the Lord sees my mind and my ministry. Even I wasn't a pastor, but I was a born-again child of God. And I had a responsibility to be walking with the Lord all day long. And I felt like I was walking with Him. I'd been in prayer that day, but when that man came to my mind, and I neglected to be obedient to the Lord to pray over what came to mind. That was in my spirit. The Lord was speaking to me, telling me to pray for this man. To bring back the story, the man was found in Oklahoma City dead, and I haven't seen him in 20 years. But the Holy Spirit begins to speak to your heart, and you don't know who you are in Christ. You don't know the gifts and the talents and the abilities He's given you and how important your mind is. And we have to bring every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, realizing that no matter how long we walk with the Father, emotionalism is always, always going to be a temptation.
Great example, Pastor. If we go back to Genesis 3 as we close, we see that scripture now as we try to hone everything down and say, how do you keep from walking in those things that are contrary to the Word of God, that are contrary to what God desires? And they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves. Can we say fear?
Fear.
From the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden. I was afraid." Does fear come from the Lord? God has not, I know you were right. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a sound mind, right? He was afraid and he hid himself. When you're afraid of God, when you're afraid of how He thinks about you, you won't pray. You won't read the Word.
That's right.
You'll hide yourself from God. You won't go to church. You won't be around those that are going to do those things. So here's some keys that I've written down. Number one, God desires to meet and talk with us regularly. Two, prayer is meeting and talking to God. That's what prayer is. When He came in the cool of the day, in a conversation, I was talking to Pastor Zac. I said, I wanted to know, where did prayer start? Well, you have to ask yourself, what is prayer? Prayer is nothing more than communicating with God. And God initiates it. He came walking in the cool of the day. He came beckoning my brother to pray.
That's right.
Pray for this guy.
Right.
God comes in the cool of the day. What does that mean? When things are done and you're not distracted, you hear that small voice coming through, piercing through. Prayer is a meeting and talking to God. Three, reading and meditating on the Word of God also is communicating with God. So how do we do this? Three things. One, discipline. To be a disciple to the Lord Jesus Christ means you have to be disciplined to the Word of God. So you have to have the Word of God in your heart. Guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. We have to guard our hearts to keep everything out. We've got to put something in. When Pastor Zac had that vase up here, he calls it a vase. I call it a vase. He calls it tomato. I don't call it tomato. But I call it a vase. When he had that vase up here and those ping pong balls and he poured that water and those things begin to come out, what that tells me is this, is that the Word of God and fear can't exist at the same time in your heart.
It's true.
Because your heart doesn't have the capacity to hold both. It's either faith or it's fear. Amen? So allow the Word of God to be poured into your heart and disperse that fear that's in it. Two, prayer. It's essential for our connection with God. How many of you feel like you have like a bad Wi-Fi connection sometimes with God? It's like it's just like sporadic. Like sometimes it's really good. And boy, everything's flowing. I mean, everything's just coming up so clearly and crisp. And then there's times like it's so fuzzy. Is he there? Does he hear me? Well, that's not the reality. Because your proximity to God or his people or his place doesn't determine his proximity to you. He's with us.
Amen.
He will never leave us. He will never forsake us.
Amen.
So no matter where we're at or what we're going through, don't think that God is not with you. You can find yourself downtown Oklahoma City in the most horrible place you can ever imagine. And guess what? His spirit is still with you.
That's right.
And at that moment, just like Adam and Eve, who had fallen short, he's still coming to meet with you in the midst of that situation and to call you out. Where are you? What are you doing? I often wonder, what would have happened if Adam and Eve had just said, we're just going to wait until God gets here. He's going to come at the cool of the day, and we're just going to wait because he's coming, and I'm going to tell him. You did it, but I'm still going to tell him that we were wrong. We want to make it right. What would have happened?
Amen.
Amen.
We go to one, okay? I didn't get any okays on that deal. We're going to have Christmas play next week, this time. So I'm reminding you about that. We want you to come. It is going to be a message in the play. It's just not just about the kiddos having fun. There's a message in the play. So please come. Even if your kids aren't in the play and you're grown and you don't come and see it, it's going to be good. And I want to end on this. I want to talk to you and tell you that in Mark chapter 4, as I studied the Word of God and thought about emotions, when I have time to preach next, and I'm not sure when it's going to be because we're going to have the play, then we're going to have this and that, and we're in the holiday season, I want to talk to you about the parable of the seed and the soil and how much emotions are involved with our ability to receive the Word of God. And we want you to come up here if we can pray with you. Because we believe that God can till the soil of your heart, because his seed, which is his word, is always, always, without a shadow of a doubt, capable of bearing the kingdom of God in your life. God's word never fails. And it's not a matter of the word. It's a matter of, are you going to sow it in good soil? Are you going to receive the word of God and bury it deep in your heart, and let the growth be God's deal. Let the change in your life be God's deal. It's true that we have to make wise decisions. We have to be in the right place. We've got to take some steps in the right direction. But the Lord, through His Word, will change your life and grow His kingdom in your life. And I want to tell you that we are an altar call church, not because there's necessarily anything supernatural going on that we're doing, but when you come up here and we can pray with you, we're being obedient to the Word of God, because it says that we're to come together in agreement. And actually says in James to confess your sins one to another. If it's sin, if you need healing, if you need prayer, if you've been dealing with your emotions and you're being led by your emotions and you know the Word of God says something so different than the way you feel, that's why we're here, to be with you and to pray with you, believing that our Father's Word is always true. And we want to help you. We want to pray with you. So as we end and you're dismissed after this, unless Pastor has something else to say, if we can pray with you, we want to, because we love you. And we know that it's not a matter of the power of the sin in your life. It's a matter of your willingness to receive the Word of God in your life and bury it deep in the soil of your heart. Come up here and let us pray for you if you need anything at all. We love you all. You have a blessed week.